And ye shall know the truth. The loud cry of the third angel's message to the world.
Sun and Sunday worship. Easter, the worship of pantheistic gods and goddesses. For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all unrighteousness and ungodliness of men who hold the truth in unrighteousness. Because that when they knew God, they glorified him not as God, neither were thankful, but became vain in their imaginations, and their foolish hearts was darkened. Professing themselves to be wise, they became fools, and changed the glory of the uncorruptible God into an image made like the corruptible man, and to birds, and four-footed beasts, and creeping things, who changed the truth of God into a lie, and worship and serve the creature more than the Creator, who is blessed forever.
Greetings of grace and peace, dear viewers. This is the Thusia Multimedia Ministry, and welcome to our program, And Ye Shall Know the Truth. Well, now my name is Brother Wismanand van Bruggen, your presenter, and let us begin this presentation with a word of prayer. Let us pray. Our loving Father in heaven, we thank you very much for this wonderful opportunity to be once again broadcasting the truth of the Lord Christ, the third angel's message to the people. As they watch, as they listen, as they learn, may they receive salvation from Jesus Christ, our glorious High Priest. Bless them with sincerity and love for truth. Grant me thy Holy Spirit to speak with authority and clarity of faith. In Jesus' holy name we pray with much thanksgiving. Amen. Okay, now what we are going to present to you for the following weeks is a three-part presentation on Easter, the worship of pantheistic gods and goddesses. And this is part one. And in part one, we're going to show you the rise of ancient mystery religions. Now, when we have to review the rise of ancient mystery religions, we are going to give it to you from the part from the Bible. So we've seen what does the Bible have to say about the rise of the so-called ancient mystery religions of nature worship or paganistic pantheism. That's what we are dealing with. Now, first of all, we must consider that when it comes to identifying all false religion, the problem lies with Lucifer. Why? That fallen angel. He is intently rebellious and deceptive, full of lies. And everything Lucifer says is against the faith of Jesus Christ. Therefore, it creates false doctrine. Okay? All Satan's lies and deceptions will create false doctrines, which are innately demonic. Now, my first scripture will be John, the Gospel of John, chapter 8, and verse 44. And what it is that Jesus says, he says this: "Ye are of your father the devil, and the lust of your father you will do. He was a murderer from the beginning, and abode not in the truth, because there is no truth in him. Whenever he speaketh a lie, he speaketh of his own, for he is a liar and the father of it." So what we are seeing here, therefore, is that all lies originate with Lucifer. Okay? All lies originate with Lucifer himself. Okay? And those lies are against the truth. Next scripture we turn to is 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 1. And here we see the Bible tells us what's going to happen in the last days. And it all has to do with Satan's lies against the truth. "Now the Spirit speaketh expressly that in the latter times some shall depart from the faith, giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils," or doctrines of demons. So you see, an apostasy from the faith of Jesus Christ give rise to Satan's pantheistic doctrines, doctrines of demons. Now, to get to a more factual matter of history, just after the world right flood in Noah's time, there was a great rebellion at the Tower of Babel in the early presence of Earth's history. And this gave rise to the foundations of the complexity of many false religions and many false religious concepts. And this was under the leadership of Nimrod. Let's see what the Bible says about Nimrod. We go to Genesis chapter 10, and I'm reading here verse 8 to verse 10. It says, "And Cush begot Nimrod. He began to be a mighty one in the earth. He was a mighty hunter before the Lord. Wherefore it is said, even as Nimrod, the mighty hunter before the Lord." Now, when they say before the Lord, it really means that Nimrod was in rebellion to God. The people exalted him in place of God. One quotation to identify this is taken from the book Ralph Bidrow, Babylon Mystery Religions, page 8 and page 9. I'm quoting the actual book. "Whatever advances may have been made by Nimrod would have been well and good. But Nimrod was an ungodly ruler. The name Nimrod comes from Marad and means he rebelled. The expression that he was a mighty one before the Lord can carry a hostile meaning. The word before being sometimes used as meaning against the Lord. And the Jewish encyclopedia says that Nimrod was he who made all the people rebellious against God. So what we are seeing here, therefore, is that Nimrod was a rebellious person. So Satan, in his deception, is now causing his rebellion to continue in Nimrod. What does this have to do with mystery religions? I quote from another book called The Genesis Record by Henry M. Morris, page 265. And he had this to say about the rebellion at the Tower of Babel. 265. He says, "Nimrod not only set up a military dictatorship, but also established a priestly oligarchy in which he himself was chief priest and later the chief object of worship." Okay? So what you're seeing here, therefore, is that Nimrod was now the object of worship. And since in the Tower of Babel, there was a great rebellion, it means, therefore, Nimrod was the center of worship to people's mind. Now, what about this rebellion at the Tower of Babel? Genesis chapter 11 tells us this. It says, from verse 1, "And the whole earth was of one language and of one speech." Okay? And it goes now further. Let's go down to verse 4. "And they said, go to, let us build us a city and a tower, whose top may reach unto heaven. And let us make us a name, lest we be scattered abroad upon the face of the earth." It continues down to verse 7. I'll go to verse 7. It says, God speaking, "Go to, let us go down, and there confound their language, that they may not understand one another's speech. So Yahweh scattered them abroad from thence upon the face of all the earth, and they left off to build the city. Therefore is the name of it called Babel, because Yahweh did there confound the language of all the earth. And from thence did the Lord scatter them upon all the face of the earth." So the people, therefore, in their rebellion, had this Tower of Babel set up. They built a tower whose top may reach unto heaven, that they may glorify the heavens. And remember, as we showed you, that Nimrod was the one who was leading in this rebellion. Let me quote again to show Nimrod's rebellion at the Tower of Babel. I'm going to quote again Genesis Record, page 270 to 272, some statements here. It says, "Nimrod must have realized that they needed a strong religious motivation as well, a motivation powerful enough to overcome their knowledge that God had indeed commanded them to fill the whole earth. The tower was designed to satisfy that need as well. The tower was not designed to reach the heavens, that is, to reach the spiritual resources available in heaven. The words 'to reach' are not in the original. they would build a tower unto heaven. In other words, a tower dedicated to heaven and its angelic hosts. So the people were now worshiping what? So-called angels in heaven. But what about this concept about worshiping angels in heaven? It says in page 271, it says here, there was indeed a host of angels in the heavenly places, but vast numbers of these were fallen angels under the hierarchical control of Satan. God's holy angels were no doubt appalled at these developments in Babel. It says also, but no such inhibition hindered the rebellious angels, the evil spirits or demons. They revelled in it and encouraged it, for all this was in accord with the desire of Lucifer, their master, to become God himself. So what you're seeing here is that the whole issue of the Tower of Babel was Lucifer's plan, his lies, his anti-truth, setting up Nimrod as the one who is to be worshipped because of his rebellion against God. And the people was now deifying Satan in Nimrod. Another quotation, page 272. It says here, as they had done before the flood, these evil spirits began to control the minds and bodies of those human beings who were open to such possession and guidance, especially those of the priests and priestesses who had become devoted to this system of worship. To the innermost circle of these initiates, demonic revelations were given. To some, perhaps especially to Nimrod, Satan revealed the entire conspiracy against God. From some such beginning, soon emerged the entire complex of human religion and evolutionary pantheism, promulgated via a system of astrology and idolatrous polytheism, empowered by occultic spiritism and demonism. So what we have here is that at the Tower of Babel, the foundation was laid for the development of false religion. And what does God say about this in the Bible? Romans chapter 1. From verse 18 to verse 25, the Bible says this. Here what Paul got a great revelation to understand how the apostasy from the truth came and developed into the pantheistic, paganistic religions which Christianity had to fight against, which today we are seeing in the worship of gods and goddesses in the festival of Easter. I read from verse 18 to 25, Romans chapter 1. It says, for the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who hold the truth in unrighteousness, because that which may be known of God is manifest in them, for God had revealed it unto them. For the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse. Because that when they knew God, they glorified him not as God, neither was thankful, but became vain in their imaginations or in their reasonings, and their foolish hearts were darkened. Professing themselves to be wise, they became fools, and changed the glory of the uncorruptible God into an image made like unto corruptible men, Nimrod, and of course his wife Semiramis, and to birds, and four-footed beasts, and creeping things. Wherefore God also gave them up to uncleanness, through the lust of their own hearts, to dishonor their own bodies between themselves, who changed the truth of God into a lie, and worship and serve the creature more than the creator, who is blessed forever. So what you're seeing here is the whole mode of development of how people moved away from the one true God and began to lay the foundation to worship creation as God. And that is Lucifer himself. And Lucifer planted that in the worship of Nimrod, so that all over the nations of the earth, people begin to deify Nimrod in many different cultures and many different festivals. Okay? So now, my dear people, as a result of this great apostasy, the glorification and the worship of the heavens became very precise. People begin to deify the heavens. They begin to worship the heavens. I quote one scripture on that. I look at Deuteronomy chapter 4, verse 19. And here we see the worshipping of the heavens actually taking place. Deuteronomy 4 and verse 19 tells us this. It says, "And least thou lift up thine eyes unto heaven, and when thou seest the sun and the moon and the stars, even all the hosts of heaven, shouldest be driven to worship them and to serve them, which Yahweh, the Lord thy God, hath divided unto all nations under the whole earth." So people, what we are seeing here is that God is saying, do not worship the stars of heaven. Lucifer is a fallen angel, a fallen star. And he caused the whole earth to now be switched to deify the heavens. The Tower of Babel was unto the heavens to glorify the heavens. And that was seen in Nimrod. What does that mean after all? It means people therefore then began to worship what? Idols. Idols has now been made to satisfy people's curiosity in worshiping fallen angels. Psalms 96 verse 3 to verse 7 gives us this idea. Psalms 96 verse 3 to 7 tells us this. It says this. It says, "Declare his glory among the heathen, his wonders among all people. For Yahweh is great and greatly to be praised. He is to be feared above all gods. For all the gods of the nations are idols, but Yahweh made the heavens." Okay? So Yahweh is the only true God who have to be receiving the true glory after all. So what we are seeing there, for the apostasy from the truth led people to deify what? Nimrod. First, Lucifer wanted to be God. He let that whole concept be channeled towards Nimrod, who led a great rebellion upon the face of the earth. Then people now begin to glorify Nimrod. And as God destroyed the Tower of Babel, people begin to identify Nimrod in many ways, in idolizing creation or the stars of heaven, the moon, the sun, the stars, and different forms of manifestation upon the face of the earth. And this is why, you know, you have idols representing different forms of Nimrod's rebellion or his concept of deity. Now, what does all this have to do with Easter? In regards to Easter, this festival glorifies the male and female forms of pantheistic deities, primarily Nimrod and his wife, or Nimrod in many different forms as a baby. Okay, Nimrod as a hunter, whatever. It also identifies the fruitfulness of nature. Easter is also identified as a fertility or sexual rites worship. It is not a Christian festival or has any biblical foundation as related to Jesus Christ, his death and his resurrection. Okay? Plainly to tell you, this Easter festival is the worship of the goddess Ishtar in her various identities, and is also the male god Tammuz in different identifications. Let me give you a statement from a wonderful book here. It is called The Real Story Behind Christmas, Easter, and Halloween. It is by Vance Farrell, page 51 and page 52. And this is what he had to say. He says, Easter, right? A pagan god described who was resurrected each spring on Easter, a day which was dedicated to Ishtar, the mother goddess. She was also called the Queen of Heaven, who interceded with the gods on behalf of mankind. This mother goddess was variously known as Astarte, Ishtar, Astoreth, Sibyl, Demeter, Ceres, Aphrodite, Venus, Freya, or Isis. Astarte was the most important goddess of pagan Semites. She was the goddess of love, fertility, and maternity for the Phoenicians, the Canaanites, the Armenians, South Arabs, and even the Egyptians. Her name was Ishtar in Babylonia and Assyria, where she was also the goddess of war. The Old Testament stories call her Astoreth. Okay? Now, what about Tammuz? What about Tammuz? Of course, it speaks about Tammuz as well. Let's go to the Unger's Bible Dictionary, and we'll see what it has to say about Tammuz, page 417. Okay, Unger's Bible Dictionary, page 417. And it says this about Tammuz. It says here, Tammuz. Who was Tammuz after all? It says, Ezekiel refers to the worship of the Babylonian deity in a vision of his apostate brethren who were enamored of this cult. The prophet saw the woman weeping for the god at the north gate of Jerusalem. Tammuz was known by the Babylonian name as Dumuzi, god of pasture and flocks, of Sagittarian water and of vegetation. He was the husband brother of Ishtar or Asira, fertility goddess. Tammuz supposedly died every autumn when he departed to the underworld. He was recovered by this disconsolate Ishtar. His appearance or his reappearance marked the bringing forth or the bursting forth of life in the springtime. Tammuz is equated with the Greek Adonis and the Egyptian Osiris. So what you are seeing here, people, it also says that the rites of Tammuz included a divine marriage of the king annually to the fertility goddess in the person of a temple priestess. So what you are seeing so far about this Easter, based upon these wonderful quotations, is that these deities, Ishtar and Tammuz, has various names. Either you call her Isis, you want to call her Astarte, you want to call her Venus or Freya. Either Tammuz, you want to call him Osiris, you want to call him Adonis. Okay, whatever the names are, it refers to the same god based upon the different nations and different cultures. The fact is that this cult, this sexual cult, because she's a fertility goddess, it's also a nature worship. Why? Because it happens in spring. Okay, it is based upon fertility because she's fruitful in bringing forth life. And also Tammuz by his death and his resurrection. So this has nothing to do with Jesus Christ, my dear people. Don't be deceived about these things. Okay? Therefore, what we see about Easter is that it is the deifying of false gods. It's the deifying of false gods. Let me give you another statement. I'm going to quote something from a book by Madame Blavatsky. The book Isis Unveiled, page 444. Isis Unveiled, volume 2, page 444. By Madame Blavatsky. She says, in the world of stars and planets, she is known as Ishtar or Astoreth. Hence, she is identical with Venus and every queen of heaven to whom cakes and buns were offered in sacrifice. And as all the archaeologists know, with Eve, the mother of all that live, and with Mary, Isis, Astarte, Venus, Aphrodite, all of whom were goddesses of the generative powers of nature. Can't you not see who this Easter is all about? Astarte is Easter spelled without certain, take out certain words, you will see it. And the same thing with Tammuz. Let me give you one more statement about Tammuz there. One more statement about Tammuz. I'm going to quote from the Golden Bough, page 325. And hear what this statement says about Tammuz. The Golden Bough by Sir James Fraser, right? Sir James Fraser. He says this. Under the names of Osiris, Tammuz, Adonis, and Attis, the people of Egypt and Western Asia represented the yearly decay and revival of life, especially the vegetable life, which they personified as a god who annually died and rose again from the dead. So this has nothing to do with Jesus Christ. It's a falling away. It's an apostasy from the truth. And I'm saying these non-truths, these anti-truths, is Satan's lie and his hate for Jesus Christ. So all persons who want to worship and glorify Easter, you are worshiping the enemy of truth, Lucifer. You are actually in rebellion against God because you're worshiping what? False gods. And these gods are gods that Satan had set up through the rebellion of Nimrod. And Nimrod was he who was a hunter before the Lord. and he created rebellion upon the face of the earth. The first worldwide war and rebellion against God. What I talk about. So today, my dear people, Lucifer is using false doctrine, such as Easter, to cause the world to come in rebellion against God. It's about time you learn. As you watch, as you learn, as you listen, I pray you receive salvation. Because you shall know the truth. Because the end of what we are teaching you here, therefore, is that you will come to see the truth of Jesus Christ and that you could be saved. By the grace of God, we hope that you will be willing to recognize that God is truly the one true God and Savior. Because all these things are designed to give you one knowledge, the knowledge of Jesus Christ as your God and Savior. My final quotation here. Page 147 from Mystery Babylon Religion by this writer here. Right? Let's read this final quotation here. He says here, 147, he says, according to the old legends, after Tammuz was slain, he descended into the underworld. But through the weeping of his mother Easter, he was mystically revived in spring. So I quote that to show you again that the whole issue about Easter is the goddess Easter and the god Tammuz. Remember, you can receive these productions. Just give us an email. We have a book coming out fully. You'll receive, just send an email, you'll get it. And of course, you will get productions here. May God richly bless you as you watch, as you learn, as you listen, and you receive salvation. Let us pray. Loving Father, do bless the hearts of all people, and as they consider the knowledge of the truth presented to them, may you bless their hearts, for they shall know the truth, and the truth shall make them free. In Jesus' holy name, amen.
And ye shall know the truth. The loud cry of the third angel's message to the world.